Oh, please, louder. Hello. Are we live? Yeah, that's the one. Oh, that's better. There you go. Let's wait for everyone to pile in. And let's get a link and send it to Instagram so that everyone follows along. Oh, Carlos, you're the first. Congratulations, buddy. How do I pop out? There you go. There you go, popping out the chat so I can see. Hey. Hey Brian, what's up, some guy? How you doing? I can't see my own live link. Why? How do I do that? Oh boy, it's very complex, very complicated. How's everyone? How's it going? Just give me a minute. I'll be right away with you. I should have done that before. But because I'm always in a hurry. This is gonna take a lot of time. Let me just publish this. And no, I don't want my face. Live on YouTube. All right, that should be it. How's it going? Sorry about that. Sorry. Really sorry. Not organized. It's not as cold as in the United States, but it's cold for us. Cody, picture cars if you have not all of car to taking. So you mean that if you don't have the car, I mean you can always, I don't know, find a photo or a model, which actually is one of our point to discuss today, and I'm going to show you how I shot the Pagani. But before I do so, I just wanted to give you an update about one of my courses. And if you've subscribed to, let me show it to you. It's very hard this way. All right, so there you go. Okay, so if you subscribe to my course, which is the McCann S tutorial, I've included an additional bonus tutorial, which is this one, the one that you see in on the screen, and I explain how I shot it. So it's like a two-in-one kind of a course. If you scroll down, it's a bonus edit over here, and I go about all the steps. I've enabled two previews for you. I've left a link in the description. I'll also leave it down here for you guys. Let me okay. It's going to take a lot of time. Let me. Yep. Just want the chat. Nunu, good evening. It's good to see you down here. There you go. Hello, Sweden. Seattle. Wow. So, how cold is it in Sweden and Seattle? I bet it's too cold. Hi, Kugan. Hello, Romania. Wow, international. Amazing. Got international audience. I wonder who's going to hijack today's live, right? Okay, let's go to the library. Or maybe. Okay, I got a question. I think it was yesterday. Well, let me answer this before we go with the edit. Someone asked me, how do you black out windows? Now I'm going to show you a quick way of doing this, and I would use the pen tool. It's pretty easy. It's all about selections. I prefer using the pen tool. Now this is not high res, and 13. Oh, 13 is not bad. Yeah. Dark and gray. I think I've covered that a lot, but we'll get into it. I left that tutorial. I don't like a lot of dark and gray stuff. All right, so I'm using the pen tool right now, and I'm going to roughly just go over this just to show you an example. And I'm just doing a rough selection just for you to see how to black out windows. All right. And it's pretty easy. It's all about perfecting selections. Now you need, if you are into car photography in Photoshop, you really need to get used to the pen tool, because you'll be using it a lot, trust me, a lot. And at some certain point of your retouching life, you will end up using it. So don't be scared of it. I didn't do that correctly, properly. All right, so now I'm going to do a selection. 0.5 is a radius. I'll select the whatever tool, the bucket, I'll call it, and then there you go. Now this is not black 100%, but yeah. Okay, this is like one way. Now I wouldn't always do it 100% black. I might do a gradient. You can see that my selection here wasn't really 100% as well. But this is one way, oops, of doing it. With the selection tool, I would actually really, really recommend using a gradient. What else I can do, for example, if this is the color that I want, and let's say I get another shade maybe of gray or black, I'll select a brush, and where is it? Yeah, I'll drop this down. I'll get into the chat in a bit, and I'll just like do a few strokes. Of course, this is like very rough right now, just to give you an idea. I mean, is not like wow, but you get what I'm trying to achieve, right? Now you can see that there is a bit of what do they call it? Forgot the name of it. I would blur this out. So I would go to Gaussian blur, and I might just increase that a little bit. And yeah. I can't see properly because the light is hitting, but you see where I'm going for, what I'm trying to say, right? So it's just a matter of selection, blacking out, for blacking out the window. And you need to get better selection than this, to be honest, just to get it right. Cool. So I hope that answered one of your questions. And now we'll go to the Pagani. Is a Pagani. So the famous Pagani shot, Pagani, which is this one over here. Yeah, yes, banding. You're right. Hello. All right, before I get into the Pagani, let's see. All right, so Carlos, if you actually, if you've been following along, let me find that tutorial for you. I do have that on my YouTube channel somewhere, but let me just pull it out for you. It's somewhere. Yeah, I think this one. Please don't start with an ad. Of course. At times, you're making a lot of profit.
You have
All right, so this is the tutorial. I don't know if you've seen it before, but let me just play.
To take this photo and turn it into this using Photoshop.
You see gray out a little bit. It's just like
right after the intro.
So let me just paste that link for you. Where did the link go? Yep. Let me close this. Oh boy, this chat thing. And I can't have the option to swap windows. All right, there you go. This is the tutorial. Carlos. Granada, Spain, awesome. Okay, Canon RF. No, what is it? I've seen the R, Canon R, and the PR, isn't it? Hi from the United Kingdom. I use the, hi Nunu, I use the Sony A7 III with a 24-105 lens, G lens. I see where you're going though. hey. Okay, so back to the Pagani. Okay. All right, let me tell you how I ended up with this shot. And honestly, the first thing I did in this is I went on to Shutterstock. Yeah, Shutterstock. And I looked for backgrounds. And let me show you what it was wrong from my side. Hello. Let me get you the Shutterstock. So I think I had like walls or something. Yeah, there it is. Oops. Yeah, there. Let me get it right here. So I saw this, right? And I really like it. And the model car is it's a Pagani. I got off eBay. Give me a second. Now this is the car. Now this is made by BBR. I buy one of these every year. They're a bit expensive. And this is the first time I'm buying a Pagani. And the reason why I picked up this model, to be very transparent and honest, I think this is the best model car. I mean, I tried APR. Oh, sorry. What was it? Not APR. APR is a performance thing. Ah, AutoArt. And they are not as detailed as this. I mean, the details in this, I don't know if you see it properly, but it's freaking amazing. So yeah, I took a lot of time to find this, and I can't find the chat window because I did not press the chat window. Oh, there you go. Right, so okay, so now back to the subject. So I found this background. I wanted to get the Pagani in. So now there is a tutorial. I forgot the name of it. What is it called? Oh, thanks Rozzy. I'm glad I've helped. Is Lightroom free? No, it's not. I use the cloud-based Lightroom and I pay a monthly. It's a monthly payment and you get Lightroom and Photoshop all bundled in. So it's worth actually getting. What's wrong? What is it? What is the wrong part? Hey, Cody. So yeah. And honestly, I took few shots, like you can see here. I don't know if you see the setup. Well, let me see if I've got the Profoto B1 with a 4x2 softbox. The back is a 4x2. And in front, I have a white reflector. It's just a piece of card. I don't know what they call it. I bought it off from the bookshop. Yeah, it didn't cost a lot. I think it was like less than a dollar. And the light here hits the card and then it reflects back on the car because it was pretty dark in front. But I also have adjusted the light to get the side of the car as well. So that was how it was shot. And I took several. It took some time until I got the angle kind of a bit right. So this was off. This is where I started. And you can see I had a lot of shots to get the lighting right first and then the angle. And you get better once you try it a few times. Okay, so let's open that in Photoshop. Let me show you how it is done. Pagani. Yeah, an original. Hey, it's less, or hey is less? Which one is it? All right, here we go. Curves. This was just to darken. Let me start from scratch out of the bottom. And this is the before versus the after. Didn't do much, honestly, on the background. Well, I think it is. I mean, it's not like I have a Pagani accessible for me. So I bought a Pagani model car off eBay and there you go. It's a model car. This is just for the lighting. I just used a curve with a mask. So this is without the mask. And this is with the mask just to give it that, you know, just emphasize that light heading from the background. And this was smoke. I'm not sure if I have that. I don't think I actually enabled that. But yeah, let's start again. We've got here, and then this is the car layer. Let me enable the car layer. Whoa, where is it? Okay. Enabled. So this is the car over there. Over the table, I would say. Let me disable all the other elements. Headlamp. And lamp two. Yeah. Okay. I use the pen tool, of course, to trace out the car. And I once I traced up the car with the pen tool, remember, it's always the pen tool is essential. You need to get really good with the pen tool because, like I said, at some certain point of time, you're retouching life, you will use it and you will have to. And I applied a mask. But now the car looks floating. Now, about the position of the car, I'm trying to remember the name of the tutorials that are available. What was it? Vanishing Point. Vanishing Point. I think Vanishing Point. I'll get you a... I'll get you a link in a bit. So I drew the main shadow first. And that was very simple. And I controlled it with a mask, as you can see over here. Very simple, just subtle. Gets stronger next to the tire, to the wheels, and then fades out and then comes back in when you're next to the wheel and then fades back again. And the second layer, which is the main shadow, the bigger shadow. Then again, it starts like dark. And I think, honestly, looking at it, I've blurred it too much given, you know, the light source is very strong in the back. I could have used just less blurring. Oh yeah, Angelo, sorry about that. I told you guys that I'm gonna come in, but I didn't tell you when. Anyway, so it fades out, and you can see here it fades out really heavy kind, and then it slowly fades away again, and slowly fades away again. All right, so these are the two shadow layer. Now, what you can see over here, there are several things that you can see. There's a color cast spread because of the base layer over here. It was red, and it just like threw red everywhere, just below the car. Now, I've darkened the car as well somewhere. But I'm not sure when. I'm not sure where. I got a palpitation. Give me a minute. All right. Okay. And then I added the hue and saturation. And that's just to remove the red over here. So if I go to the reds, you can see I desaturated the red. I don't know if you are able to see the red. Do you see the red color cast on top of the car here? You see it, right? Now, if I do this, it's gone. Before, after, before, after. All right. And then I did some cleanup on top of the car with, what is it called? Yeah, either the spot healing brush. I think it's the healing brush tool. And I went over the car. I mean, you can see a few spots down here, 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 and there. And I was able to remove it with that. I wasn't really very precise. I knew that this was just going on Instagram as well. Whew. All right. Headlamps. And this is for the right part. And I just used a brush, really. Let me see. Yeah, it was just a rounded soft brush, stroked it once, transformed it, and I've put that on top of the light. I'm losing my breath as it reflects again while having a life. Feet is not fun. Okay, where's water? Forgot to get me water, god damn it. Anyway, and the one next to it is, I don't know what I was thinking, to be honest, but I kind of like the shape of that over there. And it comes into place once you see the stroke of highlights coming out of the light. I think I did that with a pen tool. And I did the same thing on the other side. Transformed it, made it a bit smaller. And car shadows. What is this about? Oh, okay, sorry, I was on the group. It's the entire group, car and shadows. I don't think I've used this. I mean, that's something that I wanted to add on top of the light to give it that flare, but I don't think I've actually used it. I should delete those because they get me confused. And it's just a screen, on a screen blended mode, and stroked once. Capiche so far? Oh wow, there's a lot in the chat. I'm glad you like the final result, Nunu. Hi, Chris. And hello. Did you change the color of the car, or is it lighter from the effect? I think it's just the light, how the light hit the car on the side. It's kind of soft, so it gave it that really nice look. You see, with darker colors, it's hard to photograph because they don't reflect a lot of things. So the best thing to do is actually reflect, having a white reflector somewhere, or a big wall, something huge. In my case, because it's a toy car, I was able just to bring the light source a bit to the side, and that took care of it. All right, you're a little bit late, not too much, Angelo. Would you be able to show how to get rid of the flare sunspots? Do you have a link? I do have a link. I'll get you a link. But if I don't, if I forget, check out 85mm's tutorials on YouTube. He has one over there. Yeah. Yeah, I should do that, Razi. I'm just being like lazy. I should do that. I'm trying to get back to it. I know, guys, I've been away for a while, but I've been very, very busy, obviously. But I'll be back, I promise. Fantastic. Oh, thank you, Robert. Hello. Hello. Did I get to drive the Pagani? Of course. Especially if it's when it's a toy car. You were the one, right? Told you I can't drive something that I can't afford. And turns out it was just a toy car. Okay, moving forward. Right, yellow. Yeah, so I added this later on. It wasn't part of the edit. Again, it's just soft round brush. This, the first one is white. And then the second one with a bit of color. And then the third is bigger soft light with screen. Both of them are screen. Set, I mean, the blending mode are set to screen. Where are your manners, Mo? And I did the same thing for the one on the left. I just copied it and transformed it. And then I added a contrast layer, I think, from Luminar. It's very, very subtle. I think I've decreased. Yeah, it was at 100%. This is what 100% is. And then, of course, you know that I've changed from Camera Raw to Luminar. Let me bring that up. Now, why I shifted, I mean, it does about the same thing, but Luminar gives you more flexibility, really, in comparison to what Camera Raw give you. So here it is. I just used the detail enhancer. There are a lot of filters that you can add. And I explained this in my course as well. The one with the Jaguar. So, you know, with adjustable contrast, brightness and contrast. The ones I use are the color contrast when there is a flare or something that gives it that enhancement. Advanced contrast. And what else do I use? I'm just telling you what I use. And the good thing, it gives you exactly the details here, right? So there's sharpening, you can read the details, you understand what it is and how it works. Denoising and stuff like that. Okay. Who was the person's name of what? Hala hala ba Ali, Kazi, what's up? Let me press cancel. What are those two cars behind you? Oh, these are my other toy cars that I bought. I've got a Corvette, a Ford, and the classic. Okay, so front light, right. Yeah, let me expand this. It's a curve, and I use the pen tool to draw that light. Oh, you wouldn't be able to see it. Well, let me. So it's a curve down here. That's a curve. So the way it's done, and I'll just show you an example. So I do this, that. Of course, it's very rough. I make a selection. All right, and then I use a curve and I increase the curve and then you have a light. Now, of course, this is very rough, so you need to soften it with a Gaussian blur. And if I bring this here, you can see the more you add, the softer it becomes. Okay. Let me show it to you. Let me show you exactly how it was done. Gaussian blur. All right. And I'll increase, I can't remember how much radius I used, but let's say I use that much. Now, this looks good, but you can make it better. So since we have a mask over here, I'll grab a black brush with an opacity of 17 is good, and I'll start fading. Sorry. Let's make sure this one is selected and press X. Make sure it's a black mask and then start fading it out from the bottom, a little bit from the top. We can go lower so you can get more accurate detail. There you go. And this is exactly what I've done at the bottom. If I go before, you can see the headlights as if it got turned on. Now, I think the next layer is the smoke. So I added a smoke layer on top of it. So I don't know if you see it. Let me zoom in. Oops. And if I do it before, after, you can see a bit of smoke. And I dialed it down and controlled it with a mask. Without the mask, there'll be just a lot. I just wanted a bit of smoke over there. And I think I just added a stroke of brush on top as well. Cool. Of course, I put that in a group and I again applied a mask to fade the entire light from the left to the right. And then I did the same thing for the other light. And it's barely visible. I added a bit of logo down, up here for the Huayra. I think that's what it's called, right? Pagani Huayra. And yeah, we're approaching the end. So, and then I just added a color. Actually, I don't like the color lookup, so I added my own grade and color balance. I graded this with a color. Balance. And I use it, I think, mainly between the mid tones and the shadows. So the shadows, I added a bit of blue. So if I turn this to the left, it becomes yellow. More to the right, it's more blue. So I really used subtle ones. A bit of red and, a bit of cyan and then a bit of greens as well. And I did the same with the mid tones. And I added the curves. You see, I like using curves, even for the entire thing. And just to darken it, I inverted the mask. And actually, I didn't invert the mask. I just used the black brush to remove the mask from here, because otherwise it becomes dark. And that's about it. It's all right, Angelo. You'll find this pre-recorded, right? So is it pre-recorded? Anyway, you'll find it online. Not pre-recorded. I mean, you'll find it online. I can't find the words today. And I'm suffering from a acid reflux, and it's killing me. Phone's about to die. I can't find the charger. When you finish your RAW file, you go to export. What sizes you save? Pictures for Lightroom. Good question. Honestly, I use one size for all. I just use 100% in Lightroom, export it as it is. Instagram will compress the photo. Now, I know this is maybe not the right approach, but they will compress the photo. So if you give them a big size, it's better, because you don't want to compress a photo and then compress it again with Instagram. It will do double compression. So I always like to just like send it to my email at full res and then just post it. And if I want to use it somewhere else, send it to a friend, send it via email. I have the full res. All right, so let's go to Lightroom. So if I go to the export, right? So this is exactly the default. So Yeah, I mean, you can dial it down to 75, which gives you a little bit more controllable size. This is 100. Image sizing, I just leave it as it is. I don't know which version are you using, but I'm using the classic version. You might be using the cloud, and really that's about it. You can change the resolution to 100. Doesn't really matter much for online. I think this is more for print. But yeah, I mean, that's how I do it. I don't know if I did any changes in Lightroom here. I just increased a bit of the shadow. Felt like the shadows were dark. And maybe added a bit of split toning as well, but very subtle. Yeah. Shutterstock. Find it on Shutterstock. Where was it? No. It's the wrong one. There you go. So shutterstock.com. Let me paste that for you. There you are. Yeah, so Lightroom, I don't know where the height and width. You can uncheck that and it will use the default settings. I'm pretty sure there are a lot of articles and a lot of people who have actually figured that out, but I just prefer using the high res and uploading it as it is. Vanishing point car. So a good way. Vanishing point Photoshop car. Yeah. So this tutorial over here, it's very important. When you do compositions, right, you need to check this video out. So let me paste it down for you. Hard to see from the camera. And there you go. Check this tutorial out about vanishing points. This guy explains what vanishing point is. It's very good for compositions. That determines how and where the car is positioned on your mocked or on your background. So do check this.
Hey, welcome to this video tutorial brought to you by TuckVid.com. We're going to talk about
check out this tutorial. Proper perspective when you're creating, I pasted a link for you right now.
Dragging one object from one photo, into another scene. How do you make it look right? You can see here with this scene in Photoshop.
Capiche? Now, if you, I think someone asked about removing flares and stuff like that. So 85 mm. You can see I also use his smoke brushes. They are amazing. There you go. No. There. Removing reflections. Now let me paste that for you. Alex McKenzie. There you go. Yeah, I mean, I had that once with the, I've got Robert here asking if I have, if I work with car dealers. I do. I work with Audi and I work with several others. We did have an issue that, you know, they didn't want to put mileage on their cars. So they would just get them on top of a truck or they will deliver them to the location. What do they call Sata? I forgot right now. But they would deliver the car to the location and then I would shoot the car. One of the latest shots were for the RS5. I experimented with different location, and I went in the morning. Turns out the sun kind of changed its position because it's winter, and I just didn't like how it came along. If you remember, I shot the Porsche down here. And actually, on this day, on this specific time, my tripod broke. So I got frustrated and I just took like a few shots and I left. I was really angry. I can't do it without the tripod. Anyway, later on, I got back my Manfrotto, which doesn't break, which I've been using it for years. And went down and shot few. So this is one of the shots. I had like small ladder with me, and this is the final one. This one was a test drive, so I was able to drive it. So if they have test drives, that's great. Now, there are some limitations with test drives. Maybe it's not the right configuration of the car, right? So different rims, different colors, and different, I don't know, configurations like the front damper or the exhaust or calipers and so on and forth. So that way you're limited with the test drive. But if you want to shoot a car and the dealer wants it, then you just tell them to deliver the car to X place and that's it. So they would send someone from their end that will actually be responsible for that for you. Yeah, that's how it's done. And this one, I didn't post this because I didn't like it. It was very experimental. This one as well didn't have a lot, but I edited it anyway. And this one is a masterpiece. This one is the best shots you can ever find. Not really. And this one was the back shot. Let me see the edit. So I shot this. They loved it. And they told me that they would love to use this for one of their ads. And I said, fine, you can use it. I'll just add the Audi Sport on top as a number plate and then use it. And this one, I think at the beginning I explained that I've actually did a tutorial, a premium tutorial on this. You can find it. You can find a link to this at the comment section of this live stream. So yeah, hit me with questions if you have any. Hang on, let me read. Steve, sorry I missed that. It's a toy. Yes, it was a toy, and I'm sorry if I missed anyone at the top. I tend to miss comments. I don't know how people like Peter McKinnon can just like see all the comments. It's like impossible. So yeah, we answered that. I go to car shows and meet at shopping center. That's a car parts. Get light flares and sunspots. So yeah, watch that tutorial. I mean, sunspots are okay if they were small. It's like, just keep them. And if you can hide them, I sent you one of the links from Alex McKenzie. And yeah, you'll be able to remove it. Double exposure, yes. Double, sometimes triple. In this example, it's double. So there were two. The raw files are also included in that premium tutorial. So this is one, and this is the second. The idea is basic. I wanted to remove reflection just from here in certain spots of the car. I explained it pretty well, I think, in that tutorial. Actually, the Porsche mechanics, which is included as well in the same tutorial, I go into details on how to clean the road, how do I select what to have and remove from a car. Especially, you don't want to just remove everything otherwise. I mean, this looks okay, but you know, without that line, without that highlight, because it's a dark car as well, kind of dark. Without that highlight, it wouldn't look good, right? So look at it now. These reflections are essential, I think, in my opinion. Oh yeah, so, okay. Robert, I was just talking about this. Do I prefer removing reflections or keeping them? Like I said, I would remove some of the reflection and keep the rest. These highlights make a difference. So if you look here, it's just dull. This is very flat right now. It's very, I don't like it. There's no oomph, like they say. But here it looks great, right? I have highlights, but I don't want to show the ground. So I use two exposures and I actually just like remove it in Photoshop. There you go, it's removed. Voila, magic. How do I get nice composition? You mean with this shot? So M3GTS is asking, how do I get nice compositions? Oh, you mean with this shot? Well, I mean, I don't know if it's experience. Maybe, yeah, maybe it's a bit of experience. So it's not always that I get the right shots. I do experiment. You can see from my work here, I do try different shots. And a good thing is, here's a tip, right? Like, I know that I want certain shots to be in the cars positioned a certain way. And the good thing with Sony and maybe even other cameras, I'm not saying this is a Sony feature, is I have the LCD live view the back. And I set my focal length the way I see it fit within the location. So if I have a sun flare, it would give a bit some room to the left. If it's for advertising, usually for advertising, they would love to have some room on the left or the right to have their advertising copywriting, right? So I depend on the monitor on by camera, and I set my focal length, and sometimes I adjust it back and forth, and then I move around as well just to see if I have a better angle or I could find a better opportunity. And then I lock it. Once I find something that I like, that's it. I just lock it in. I think this was one of the shots. I didn't like it. It was like from the top to the bottom. My monitor is gone. Hello? Hello? Power saving mode. No, you're not going to the power saving mode. And it's back. So I didn't quite like that shot. The background was dull. There is a sun flare, but there is no sun. So I adjusted the camera. Give me like that. No, I liked it, but it was overexposed. So I took multiple exposure. And you can see I've rotated the CPL as well. And then after the edit, I got this. And I also tried the site profile. I mean, it's nice. Can get nicer, but I just didn't edit this shot. These are the back shots. I find this car more photogenic from the front, and this is another try as well. So I think in one of my tips previously, I mentioned that whenever you are about to shoot a car, Google the car, understand the how the car was photographed. And what is the best angle you can get this car at? Is it low angle, high angle? Is it left, right, front shot, side shot, two-third side, and so on and forth. Hello, Norway. How you doing? Yeah, yep. Okay, so how does one get those colors in the headlights? What do you mean? So I got Angelo here. Asks how one gets those colors in the headlights. What colors? What did I miss? You mean these colors? I think it's just the material, really. I think so, which is a very valid question. The rainbow thing. I don't know if it's a CPL thing, is it? So if I rotate the CPL, actually, it affects it, but yeah. You mean this? No? I think it's the material of the light. You know how rainbows works with that thing, right? But it's a valid question. I never thought of it before. I think the angle of the light. How could I best shoot? Okay, I've got Austin asking here, how could I best shoot photos in low light if I don't have a professional aperture light? What would you recommend? Oh yes, I do have a full video on this. So if you go to my YouTube channel, it's about light painting, and I use the Yongnuo 362, something like that. But check out, it's on my YouTube channel, the light painting kit. It's with the Jaguar shot. So have a look at that. I explain the tool, everything in that video. And actually then in the next video, I explain the post-processing behind it. So it's very cheap, very affordable, and very clean light. And I prefer it on my ice light, which is very expensive. I think the Godox, sorry, the Yongnuo with the Godox softbox is perfect. And you won't have to break the bank for it. So check it out, Austin. Right, every time. Okay, I messed the thread. Where am I? Hi, Poland. How you doing? And Australia. Awesome. Got a lot. I've got an international audience. That's the beauty of this. Okay, somebody's hijacking this session. I'm just kidding. Every time at the top of the picture. What, the one on the top photo? You mean this one? Let me just enable the filter. And flagged. Rated. So this one. So I had like a mini ladder with me. And honestly, this shot was very hard because I couldn't see. The sun was hitting my face. I just set the settings and then I took multiple shots this way. And then I checked the monitor if I got it right. And you can tell I've got like a lot of options here. And you can see the car just moved. And I moved with it as well. And it was pretty hot as well. So it's not like the perfect lighting conditions. I focus, so it depends. If I do multiple exposure, I would autofocus first to get the focus right and then just lock the focus. You can do manual as well. I think you'd be more concerned with what f-stop that you should use. So depth of field, right? So you need to understand the depth of field. For me, I just, there is an app. Before I say anything, there is an app. There is an app called PhotoPels. Have you heard of it? So PhotoPels has, I don't know if you see this, PhotoPels, okay? So this app has an depth of field calculator. So I input the focal length and I enter the f-stop and I enter as well the distance between me and the subject, which is the car. And it tells me what is my depth of field. So in this case, it's 3 meters. And it tells you, because you know, focusing works, let's say you're here, and this is the subject. So when you focus, your focus point, the focusing actually covers a plane, right? So you have a bit to the front of the subject, I can't remember how much, and then the back of the subject. And it actually shows it to you right here. So in our case here, it's 1.29 meter front, near front, and 1.75 at the back. So PhotoPels get you that. And I think there is a video about depth of field. Let me look it up for you. Let me bring the chat here so I don't lose it. Oh, depth of field. DOF. DOF. Have a look at this. Okay, not this ad, but this. All right, so have a look at this. This explains the depth of field. But use the app. It has a calculator. It's not free. It's called PhotoPills. Let me write it down. Photo. I don't know if it's one word or two. PhotoPills. Just like so. Okay, so when I focus, for example, in this case, so this is kind of the center of the car, or this is where I would focus in this case, because I know that I would need to get a bit from the front and the back, a bit from the front and a bit from the back, which is here. So if I focus here, focusing starts somewhere here, it ends up there, depending on the focal length, of course. So if you sometimes focus down here, it will start sharp and then gets blurry, depending on, again, the focal length, the distance from the subject, and the f-stop. Make sense? Have a look at that video. It's very important that you understand how focal length or depth of field works. Hello, South Africa. How you doing, Brian? I got tripod, almost polarized. So I use a polarizing filter. Why did you set a 4.5? So it depends, the f-stop. It's a calculation. It's not a rule that you need to use either 4.5 or f9 or f11. I mean, for me, I do most of the time. This is how I do it. I don't depend always on the app. I know that for this subject distance, with this focal length, I would need this much f-stop. So I do a test shot, and then I would check the camera, the photo and the camera for a focus. And I would look at the back, and then I would look at the front to see everything is sharp and not blurry. So you use a CPL filter. I mean, you don't always get everything off. Even in this photo itself, I do keep reflections. Don't get bothered with them. Like, look at this. There is a bit of reflection. I understand because it's a desert and it doesn't have buildings. But I think in one shot, I rotated the CPL filter. Now, I think it's been rotated here as well, yeah. So you don't always get red 100% of reflection. And you can see here, it's been eliminated, kind of. But why is it working here and it's not working there? And it's all about the relation. It's all about this, the source of the light, the sun, and the angle of the object. So if I moved a bit to the left, I might have been able to eliminate reflections 100%, but moving to the left will not give me exactly the shot that I need. So, and you can remove most of the reflections in Photoshop. And again, if you watch, I think Damien has a Photoshop tutorial on how to do so. Check Damien Plesko. He shows how to get rid of reflections. And sometimes you can, sometimes you can, sometimes you ruin it. So if it's very hard to remove for you, just keep it there. Try to eliminate most of the reflections, but not everything. I mean, I kept even these over here. Otherwise, it will look like CGI, which I tend to like and hate at the same time. All right, where are we? Sorry, I'm just trying to get hang of the chat. Yeah, it could be. It could be that. It could be because of the CPL and the material itself. When you shoot an Alfa Romeo, it's very more crazy. Of course, the Alfa Romeo, the 8C was the best car I've shot. And I have to admit, I think it's a very photogenic car. A car that would look awesome from any angle. I would just like point and shoot and it would still look great. Those designers. Yeah, use that. It's a PhotoPels is really good. And it also tell you, and the good thing about PhotoPels, it tells you where the sun is, right? I'm pretty sure you've used that before, but it's not visible maybe now, but it will tell you where, now it's showing me the distance for the depth of field. But let me see the sun. And this is the sun part. I don't know if you see it because, you know, the screen is really small, but yeah, but this is cool. It shows you where the sun will be. The sun is actually there, so I can't tilt everything. Check it out on Google. So it will tell me where the sun will be at a certain time. So if it's 7 a.m., it will tell me exactly where it will be for that location. And once it sets, it will show you where it will set, and it will just give you where the position of that, and will tell you when will this golden hour start and when will it end. So it gives you really nice accurate information, and I tend to use that for this. Okay, what is the name of the app? PhotoPels? No, it's PhotoPels. I got there. Oh, sorry, Robert. Yeah. Hello, Philippines. Where did we reach? Do you have any problems using the wide angle lens setting the subject left and right? I don't use a lot of wide angle, to be honest. Of course, if you are going to use a wide angle and if the subject is to the left or to the right, it will get that distortion. Maybe that's something that you can fix, of course, in Lightroom, yet I don't think I would recommend using a wide lens if the subject was very to the left or right, to the either side of the photo, if the subject was in the middle, maybe I prefer that better. I don't use the wide lens as much as I used to. 24 is the widest I can go right now, maybe for reg shots as well. Maybe even for reg shots right now, I use 24. I think it's the best focal length for rolling shots and reg shots. Yeah. I'll try and have a look at your Instagram account. Maybe if you send me a direct message. I know a lot of you maybe have been sending me some private messages to have a look at your Instagram account, but please understand I'm kind of running through the busiest phase of my life. But whenever I can, I would check out. So apologies if I haven't been very responsive, and I promised myself that I will do a live streaming this week because I couldn't do it last week. Thank you, Brian. I'm glad you've learned a lot. Hey, Lithium Cars, how you doing? Hello, India. How you doing? Does the CPL have any effect on the image quality? Good question, Brian. It all depends on the material used on top of your lens, on your glass, right? So if the CPL filter, I think that's where the price differences comes in. If you get a cheap CPL filter, the material most likely going to be cheap plastic, and it will change, it will shift the colors, it will shift the quality, and if you, just use a good quality. B plus W seems to be good. And there is the Gorilla something that I've recently used. I think these are good as well. Don't get cheap. I mean, if you want to use it as a hobby, if it's a hobby and you can't afford a high-end CPL, then yes, fine. Get a cheap one. But understand that cheap CPLs will affect even any cheap filter that you put in front of your glass, if you spend a lot of money on lenses on your glass, and then you put a cheap CPL filter or cheap filter in front of it, you really have ruined that expensive glass because you're not getting the best out of it. All right, hang on. Let me get back to the dashboard. Yeah, sorry. Move things around. By the way, guys, I do have a project that I've been working on. It's called Light Shapers. So I started this Instagram account 2 years ago. And today I have reached 122,000 followers on this. Closing up to 122. See, right now it's 122,980,000. Let's wait for a minute and see how much more I gain. And it's been awesome. I mean, it's a very nice experience understanding. Okay, I didn't shoot all of this. It's just like curating the best photos with behind the scenes. So check it out. Light Shapers. I'll paste this. Let's see. Where it's 122,980. Let's do a refresh. I might have gained. It was 980, still 980. Let's wait for it and see how much I gain. Let me paste that. Rainer Express. Yeah, I'm doing some research on content marketing. All right, so let me show you the other Pagani shot. Meanwhile, right? It's always good to utilize time. This is the last thing that I'm going to show you. I thank you, Robert. So back to the Pagani, because I did two shots. The other one is a bit more complex and I had a bit of difficulties with it. So this is the shot. Yes, this is the shot. I can't remember which one I use. I think it was this one. Or maybe that one. No, this one. No, that one. So I use this one. Or this one. No. Okay, let me open that in Photoshop. This one, that one. Label your stuff, Mo. What's going on with you? The hell is wrong with you, Mo? Let's do that. I haven't tried Hoya. But maybe. All depends. I like reviews on B&H, and also they label, top sellers or most wanted. I kind of trust B&H. B&H. I don't know. I can't tell you if there is a difference between the Hoya and the B plus W because I haven't tried the BW. I didn't try the Hoya. Or maybe I did. But I think it's all in the material. All right. Let's see. So this is the Shutterstock. Photo. Again, I got this from Shutterstock, right? And let's see what I did. You can see that I did some adjustments, and I'll tell you in a bit why. And then you would see that I would bring the floor down a little bit. And that's just so the car sits correctly on top. You can see the light breaks color cast here. I need to start naming my layers. What do you think? I think it's a really good tip for me. And there is the car. So let's go to the car. That's a lot of adjustments. I might change my mind. Let me turn that off. Just kidding. So let me enable this car layer and let me just. So this is the car in its original state. Let me just remove as well as this pill. So this is the car, and you can see now it's kind of sitting right because the floor got fixed. And thanks to the guys, Dominic and Alex, and for helping me out with this. Just couldn't know. I knew something was wrong, but I just didn't know what is it. So if I remove the adjustment, you'd see that it's sitting there, but as if it's not sitting there correctly. You're welcome, M3GTS. Always here and happy to help whenever I can, my friend. Thank you guys for tuning in. Hello, Fatmer. Am I saying that right? But hi, how you doing? Okay, so now I kind of copied that layer and then I transformed it and brought it down a bit. Now, to the shadow, holy shit, I think, I'm not sure which shadows I've used, but there are three, yeah, okay. I hope so. So this is the base layer of the shadow. This is the first thing I drew as a shadow, and it follows exactly the same thing I did with the other car. And this is another copy of it, or is it not? Yeah, well, it's kind of similar, but it's more faded out. Right, and it's kind of stretched out as well. And this is the first shadow, and then I replicate that into a second shadow because we've got multiple lights and you get a lot of shadows. Although I think it's not very accurate because it should be a bit to the left. Could have worked better on this. And I'm not sure what is this for. Oh yeah, there's a shadow fix. I should name my layers. If you see at the bottom here, I just fixed that shadow there. Just didn't feel right. These two are actual spell light spell from the light break that I will actually show you in a bit. I used this layer to darken the wheel at the back. It was too bright. Oh, 49 Nix. Thank you for tuning in. 3:30 a.m. Australia. Cheers, man. Thank you for tuning on. And have a good night, I guess. And I'll see you in the next live session. I'll try and make it earlier, but if I do make it earlier, the Americans wouldn't be able to attend, or would they? So darken that up. And I did a little bit of cleanup again with Healing Brush Tool. And I removed the reds exactly the same. I used the hue and saturation and reds, put it down. And I tried to remove the reds of the car. So this is the before. This is the after. Just take it a step by step, right? It's always about taking things step by step, solving one problem at a time. And this is for matching the color. You can tell it didn't match before. I don't know if I deleted that layer. Sorry, there are a lot of color matching tutorials. Just type in color matching tutorial Photoshop. It's basically creating a layer that will show you the color difference between the subject and the background. And then you try and adjust it accordingly. So, and that's how I match the color using the selective color over here. And I added a bit of contrast because it was just too bright. And then you see the red stretch on the car. they were a bit orangey. I didn't like that. So I transformed that color and I just used, again, the red here. And yeah, that's it. It's applied to the car, so it only affects the reds. And then there is a group. Ah, there it is, the color matching. This is the color matching thing that I was talking about. So it helps me. So if I turn this off, you see the color does not match, right? So there's a lot of reds in this car, and it's not matching the color of the surrounding. And when I added the color matching, it's kind of matched. Look that up, color matching tutorial in Photoshop. It's very helpful, especially if you do compositions. Right, right tail. I didn't do a good job here either. Sorry, guys, I'm not very organized, but yeah, I mean, I'm getting there. I'm always in a hurry and I always want to do things. Now, let me show you how I did the tail light. Yeah. So let me turn off the ones over there. It must be this and that. Cool. Let me enable them one by one. So this is the first. Again, it's just a soft brush applied. And that's it. And then I added 1, 2, 3. So I always start with a white color because when I set the actual color overlay on top of a white, it gives it that extra brightness and then it fades away. What was that? All right, let me enable those, although they were supposed to be sitting in some other layer. And then the tail reds, these are basically this is a spell on top of the car, and it's very very minimal that you don't see it. You see a spell. Just like I had a soft brush, very minimal, had the opacity perhaps very low. Yeah, it's 11 in terms of opacity. And then I just stroked with a soft brush with a red color and set the blending mode to screen. So if I go to normal, this is how it will look like. And this is how it will look like. Now you can see why I added the color white first. You get that effect. Without it, you wouldn't get it. So if I turn this off, looks fake. Better that way. Maybe you can decrease the opacity of the white, but hey, kind of liked it that way. Then the left in the middle. And now for the one in the middle, because it's a brake light, usually like really red, I didn't want to add a white to it because it will look like, I don't know. And then I added a spill over. So because you have red, right? So you've got this red, but there isn't like enough spill over around. So I create another spill. And if you look, there is spill all over the place over here. Whew. All right, so moving onwards, I used camera for this exercise. And it's just a contrast, really. I think so, yeah. It's a lot of contrast. And I must have increased the exposure of the white. Let me turn that on. Let's see, what did I do? Yep, so I raised the shadows. I decreased the blacks, kind of added the contrast. I increased the exposure by half a stop almost, and clarity gave a really good boost of clarity and dehaze, just a little bit of dehaze, just to give it that grungy look. So this is the before and this is the after. Now, of course, if you didn't like that, you can always dial it down. That's the beauty of this layer, right? And I added a bit of smoke by the back. Very minimal, not too much. Just don't want it to look a lot of fakey smoke. And this is a grade with the color balance. And horrendous. Okay, I remember why I use this. I use the curve when I use the pen tool, right? So if we go back, where's the car? So I cut the car again with a pen tool. But because it was so dark, I couldn't see. I raised the midtones and everything, the highlights, just to see where I was cutting down the car. Yeah, and that's it. Where is it? Yep, that's it. Yeah, it's a toy car. Perfect time in Germany. Hello, Germany. How you doing, guys? I miss Germany. I love Germany. Tommy. I love you all, guys. I want to just... let's see. 980. Let's refresh. It's pissing me off right now because I'm not increasing followers. Oh, it's 988. So check this Instagram out, right? Light Shapers. Did I paste it? Or did I not? I don't know if I did. Well, there you go. If I did not. All right. Yes, no, it's a toy car. It's a toy car by BBR. It's an actual toy car. Where is it? Oh, Photoshop's getting slow right now. There you go. Oh, I turned it off. For you who didn't see the toy car, I own a Pagani, okay? And I get to drive it. There it is. The level of details. I don't even try to open up the doors because I don't want to scratch it. But the level of details on this. I mean, this is expensive. This is a very expensive model. I wouldn't recommend you getting that. But because I buy one, I wanted to see how good quality of a BBR is. And as you can tell, the photos are amazing. I did minimal Photoshop for this. Yeah. It broke already. I need to fix it. I broke the song. I broke the other side. It broke! I can't believe that. How did I do that? Because I was wrapping it with this. What an idiot. But anyway, that's something that I can fix, I hope. Broke the side mirror. My Pagani is damaged. I would just, super glue should do that. It's a 1 over 18, that's correct. Good eyes. It's a 1 over 18 scale model. Well, that's the final look. Now you can tell, on Instagram you can't see it. You can tell that the front side is a bit blurry because I was focusing here, somewhere here. And I needed to increase the f-stop anyway to get that right. But as long as the background, the back side of the car is in focus and very sharp, you'll find it very hard to figure this out in Instagram. If you also see here, I don't know if you see, I've added a bit of spill over of the light brakes down here and up there and a bit at the bottom, just to give it that realistic look. You're welcome. I get the backgrounds from Shutterstock. Where is it? So visit the site. Let me paste it. This is where I get my of my backgrounds. You can see I've been doing some research. Nice, some cool, nice backgrounds. Got some ideas that I want to create. But yeah, that's where I get the background from. Mm-hmm. Anyway, guys, I promised you to come online. I was in Germany last year. I'm not sure if I'm going to be in Germany, but whenever I do, this time I'm going to tell everyone, because last time was a very short notice and I didn't get the chance to tell everyone that I was coming. But when I do, I'll definitely give you guys a shout out. Especially, it's going to be maybe in the summer. Try to avoid winter, like as you can see. Yeah. So, I hopefully do visit. I'm going to wrap this up. Once again, don't forget to check out my course. So what I did is, for those who subscribe to the McCann-S tutorial on Udemy, this one, that was just a McCann-S. And then I thought, you know what, let me just give it more juice. And now people actually like it, and it got really good ratings. That was, actually, up until here is a very detailed, thorough explanation of the McCann-S shot over here, and how I use masks and how I use the pen tool and so on and forth. And then I added a bonus edit of the Audi RS5. So make sure to check that out. You can check out, I've enabled a free preview on how I actually shot it and the intro. But then I go into details on how I actually achieved the shot. And as you can see, people have left good reviews. I mean, I do have like one guy that really didn't like that. And I tried to make him understand, but he said, unfortunately, he still haven't seen anything new. But actually, I did add a lot to this tutorial. So you can check the reviews. You can see more reviews over here. Mostly they're really good reviews. And I've enabled some free previews for you guys, so make sure to check it out. And you can get that right now at $9.99. It's very cheap for two tutorials. There you go. All right, guys. Again, it's amazing to come live. I always say that I should do it every week, but you know, life just gets in the way, and I always say I'll try and do it more often. Again, if you have any tip, or if you need any tip that you want me to discuss in the next live session, do leave it in the comment section below, or I'd prefer to keep it in the comment section so I don't forget, because if you send it over Instagram, I might not see it, I might forget, and then we're gonna lose it, and I'm not going to talk about it. You see where I'm going here. All right, amigos, it's good to see you, and I'll see you in the next video. And as always, need to figure out how to close this. There you go. Stop streaming.